husband before she struck back. Is this person really a danger to you and me? If those people could just be gotten out of prison, and there are a million different creative ways and cheaper ways that we could be helping these women, that would be the one thing I would change.
How could we get people on the outside to care? Because mostly what we hear is, I have too many problems. I'm not going to worry about them. Whatever they got, they deserved. How can we make it in our self-interest to care?
It is in our self-interest to care about prisons for some, because of, in particular because of one thing that you said earlier, which is that the people who we put in prison and we mistreat come out, they rejoin us. Now, it's not just a question of angry people coming out. We have a system of health care in our prisons which is very substandard, and we have epidemics of infectious diseases, hepatitis C, AIDS, sexually transmitted diseases, tuberculosis. Those are probably the to the extent that people with infectious diseases are not treated or are undertreated in prison, they come out and they spread infection. And there's been some research done that shows that has shown that hepatitis C, for example, begins to show up in areas around prisons. In New Jersey, the Department of Corrections had to be dragged kicking and screaming by a Philadelphia Inquirer reporter to begin to even test people for hepatitis C who were coming into the system. Now, one of the things that I learned recently is that the health care of women coming into the system is even worse than the health care of men, and that women have very high higher incidence of HIV disease than men do, as well as sexually transmitted diseases. So the prisons act as an incubator, and then diseases spread. The other thing is that, and I think I want to say this a little bit differently from the way that Mia said it, these prisons are very expensive, and to the extent that we spend a tremendous amount of money locking people up in cages, we do not have that money for the drug rehabilitation and for the education and for the mental health care that we need. We have
how many of these prisons are privately run?
In New Jersey, the prisons are publicly run, but certain services are privately run, and that's another problem, because the privatized part of the prison system has included the health system and mental health systems. And the other privatized part, which many people don't think about, but which affects particularly women, is that, of course, private phone companies run the phone systems in the prison, and they charge exorbitant rates for calls. So that means that women who want to keep in touch with their children or other their parents or any other people in the family can barely do that because it's too expensive for the kind of person.
Jean, you might want to give some examples. I was shocked when I found out exactly how much you pay for a short local phone call to talk to your children.
I read something in yesterday's paper that had to do with New York State.
Yes.
That Elliot Spitzer had stopped the phone calling. I guess it was free. But now they're paying $13 and something for the first minute. Only calls can only be made charging the other party. And with a price like that, how do you keep in touch with your family?
Many people can't. And the other thing to think about is that we have an increasingly elderly population, including older women in prison. And those people also need to be able to keep in touch with what few relatives they have. We are going to try to do in New Jersey what happened in New York, which was a collaboration between litigators and community organizers. And we did get, Governor Spitzer was able to reduce the phone rates by stopping the state take of those phone profits. And we would like Governor Corzine to do the same thing, but we're going to have to prepare him for that decision.
Yes, I can see that. How is the case coming along now?
Well, the case is called Jones v. Hayman. We filed it in December. And what happened is that in March, the Department of Corrections kind of descended on a couple of units of Edna Mahan, which is the one women's prison in New Jersey, and guards in riot gear with weaponry descended on this unit of women. The women were panicked, the women were frightened. They were not told what was going to happen to them, and they were plucked out of their cells. And 40 of the women, who were actually model prisoners, were taken to one little corner of the New Jersey State Prison. In that prison, the women are confined to one unit, and within that unit, they're confined to their cells for most of every day, 20, 22 hours of every day. They're just sitting in their cells. Now, this is time when they could be learning job skills, could be doing all kinds of things, so that when they can come, when they come out of prison, that they'll be able to stand up.
They don't get any of those services?
They get almost nothing, almost nothing. And that's very different from what's happening to other women in the women's prison, and it's even different from what's happening to men in the men's prison. In New Jersey State Prison, most of the men have very little access to services and the kinds of programming and rehabilitation that our law, the New Jersey law, says that the Department of Corrections has to provide, but the women are even more deprived of these very, very essential services. So that's why we filed the lawsuit. We said it's very clear under New Jersey law that this is discriminatory. You've got men and women in the exact same prison, and the women are in very, very terrible circumstances.
I read somewhere that there are 1,800 men in this prison.
Yes.
And 40 women?
Right, exactly. And that's why, even to the extent that there are a few services here and there for men, so for example, there exists a law library, and access to a law library is incredibly important for a prisoner. Many of the men and women are appealing their criminal convictions. The women are completely denied access to the law library. If you are a woman in this prison, you do not get to go to the law library. Same thing with the prison school. There's a prison school with classrooms and teachers and learning materials and so forth. The women are categorically barred from the school. And that goes for the medical center, that goes for, you know...
Vocational.
Exactly. There's a vocational school within the prison as well. And so we brought this case. The Department of Corrections tried to get the case dismissed in several different ways. And then in April, we had a hearing. And we're waiting for the results of that hearing, the written order. But the judge indicated two things. One, that this case is going to go forward, that the department's attempts to make this case go away are going to fail. And two, she said that she was extremely concerned about the way the Department of Corrections has acted during this case. Some of the evidence that came out was that Department of Corrections officials may actually have engaged in witness tampering. That is, they may actually have gone to women who had never seen the unit where the women are currently being held and said, if you give us statements that say everything is fine, then we will cut your disciplinary segregation terms short. And a great deal of other really terrible misconduct
Very
has happened.
Shocking.
Yeah, and I think that the judge was shocked too. And so we were very heartened that our judge expressed some concern over that, and that's something that we're going to continue to look into.
Well, unfortunately, our time is up, mm-hmm. and it went very fast.
Uh-huh. Yes, it did.
I want to thank you both. We're going to be watching that case. Wish you all the luck in the world.
Thank you.
In moving ahead and also in the protections that we can provide for all women who were incarcerated.
Thank you
very much.
Thanks so much.
Thank you. We can keep on talking if you want. That's fascinating.